Shaking hands and greeting the patient is the beginning of the physical examination and the foundation of a trusting relationship. Simultaneously, with the handshake, we examine the pulse, heat or coldness, pallor or redness, any atrophies or deformities, capillary fullness, sweating or tremor. On the face, we pay particular attention to detecting asymmetries and at the same time palpate for sweating, heat, or coldness. Careful examination of the neck with particular emphasis on looking for the degree of jugular vein filling. Quick overview of the entire oropharyngeal cavity. Urolaryngeal, labial grooves, dentofacial process, tongue, palate, parietal arches, pharynx. In this phase, we sit the patient and examine the cervical lymph nodes posteriorly in sequence and meticulously. Anterior, posterior auricular, submandibular, subgenual, anterior cervical, posterior cervical, supraclavicular, occipital. As we are in this position, we examine the thyroid, and after locating it, we ask the patient to swallow, looking for the thyroid to slide under our fingers. We move our fingers toward the midline and outward so as to palpate the entire extent of the thyroid gland, paying particular attention over the jugular, where the thyroid often dives. We lift the patient's clothing and carefully survey and at the same time palpate the back. We check the straightness of the spine, painful points along its entire length, from top to bottom, and at the sacroiliac joints, and of course, the Giordano's point, listening to the lungs symmetrically in all lung fields. Lay the patient down to continue with the examination of the anterior surface of the chest. This is followed by listening to the heart with both the cone and the stethoscope membrane. This particular stethoscope changes from the cone property to the membrane property depending on the pressure applied. Finally, we also do a listening to the anterior surface of the chest. As we know, there are regions of the lungs, such as the right middle lobe, that can only be heard from the front. After reviewing the breasts for any asymmetries, we palpate both breasts with the patient's arms raised upwards, one quadrant at a time. The upper inside, the lower outside, and the upper outside, which is of particular importance because it is there, in the so-called tail of the breast, that most malignancies are found. After checking the area around the nipples, we move on to the examination of the armpits. We plunge our hands into the axillary cavity and press the rails of our fingers against the chest wall, dragging them downwards at the same time. If there are any lymph nodes, they will slide under our fingers. In the examination of the abdomen, after careful review for anaphylaxis, visible peristalsis, prolapse, asymmetry, hernias, epiphlebitis, scarring, or any other deformity, palpation is invariably preceded by listening. This is because a deep palpation can alter the intestinal sounds. Palpation starts very gently to avoid releasing pain, which will cause a false contraction. We check the flatness of the walls to rule out contraction. If we find a contraction, then to check for it, we apply a firm pressure on that point of the abdominal wall. And if the contraction subsides, then it is not a true contraction. Deep palpation of the whole abdominal area. Normally, especially in thin people, we can palpate formations such as the anionic colon, the lower lip of the liver, the abdominal aorta. We also check the upper border of the liver. There are several manipulations for the examination of the subchondral viscera. Here we also check the Murphy's point. We check the size of the liver or spleen, their texture, whether they are hard or soft, the lip, whether it is sharp or blunt, and the surface, whether it is smooth or uneven. With a little practice, we can also do a two-handed palpation of the kidneys. In deep inhalation, we feel the lower pole of the kidney coming and inserting itself between our hands. At that moment, by pressing sharply on the lower arm, the one on the patient's back, we can also check the sensitivity of the kidney. Palpation of the descending aorta. In the lower limbs, at the same time as we do the overview, we also do palpation. We look for temperature differences, sclerosis, painful areas, especially in the gastrocnemius, and edema, which are known to be located in the lower extremities, so in sedated patients, we will look for them under the thighs. We palpate the arteries, dorsal leg, posterior tibial, popliteal, femoral. Palpating the popliteal arteries takes a little practice. What is needed is to press your fingers firmly into the bottom of each popliteal fossa. Listening to the femoral triangles, which continues the listening along the descending aorta and iliac vessels, it is advisable to continue along the Hunter's ducts. Palpation for lymph nodes in the areas of the femoral triangles. And of course, search for hernias in the area. We should never skip examining the back or buttocks for swellings or ulcers. For tendon reflexes, we don't need a neurological hammer. With our hands, we can examine them perfectly. The physical examination of the patient, together with a very good history, in many cases establishes the diagnosis. The art of physical examination is never ending. The more we practice it, the more often we taste the joy of a successful diagnosis for the benefit of the patient. The physical examination has a very low cost. Its results are immediate, and at the labyrinthine crossroads of diagnostic testing, it shows us which way to go.